Hi there, guys. This is Liam from the Punks and Pubs. You're going to be listening to me in a second ramble about some shit with someone. This is an advert from the off, just to let you know. But the reason that this is an advert is not because someone's paying me. It's because I've just been happy with the service I've been provided. Merchstore.co.uk are a bunch of guys who have printed my t-shirts for me, the Punks and Pubs t-shirts. Go check them out. And they've been nothing but amazing. The reason that they've been nothing but amazing is because these guys know difficulties of getting your t-shirts printed for a reasonable price. They happen to be in bands, so they know the process of going to someone and then checking something, and then it's just a long drawn out process. But these guys have made it really simple for me, and the price has been amazing, and the quality of the t-shirts are great. So go and check them out, merchstore.co.uk. I can't make you do it, but I would definitely recommend that you do it. There you go. I'm off. Here's the intro music. I'll talk to you in a second.
Oi, oi, you punks, go on my pub.
Welcome to the Punks in Pubs podcast. My name is Liam Bird, and I hope you're all well. I have been busy with Punks in Pubs, and obviously my general life. But with Punks in Pubs, I'm not going to talk about my general life right now. That'd be crazy. Came back to Punks in Pubs. Been trying to book interviews before the end of the year. We went on our Punks in Pubs Christmas party. When I say we, I mean me and Steve, who created the Punks in Pubs video. If you haven't seen that yet, check it out, and also helps me with audio from time to time. We went on our Christmas party, we went to the Fireball Festival, but it was on a Sunday. Tip to everyone, if you haven't booked your Christmas party yet, don't do it on a Sunday, because fuck me, when you go back to work on a Monday, you feel like shit. People who followed us on the socials, you would have seen me and Steven slowly get drunker and drunker as we post more ridiculous and stupid things on our social site, which you can follow at Punks and Pubs. I'm also looking forward to 2019, booking some great people for the podcast, and fingers crossed we will be playing some live shows at festivals in Europe and maybe further afield, but you have to hang on for that. Also in London. I don't know if there's an appetite for this. I'm just trying to wing it, really. So what it will be is just me talking to a face or a person live. That's it. That is all I would be doing. I don't know if you guys would want to come and watch that, but that's something that I'm looking to do. Also, on top of that, I'm trying to flog you t-shirts. T-shirts are now up on Punks and Pubs socials for you to look at, again, at Punks and Pubs. I think they look great and amazing. Going for £15, not including postage and packaging, and they are available to pre-order. Just send an email to punksandpubs@gmail.com with your name and size, and we will stash a t-shirt away when they come into stock, and then hopefully we will get them by the 14th of December. I will drop you an email and see if you are still keen. And then if you are, what we'll do is we'll do the transaction through PayPal. So therefore, your money is safe and so is mine. But that's in the future. Let's talk about episode 27. Well, episode 27 took place in London's East End with Joshua Waters Rudge, or as I know him as, Josh from the Skints. Josh is a person I've interviewed before, and he's always been kind enough to give up his time. So I'm glad that Josh gave up pretty much most of his afternoon to sit down with me and have a beer or two. And it's that two that's kind of led this episode to be a two-parter. Basically, me and Josh spoke for about an hour 50, and that is far too long for a podcast. So what I've done is I've broken it down into two. I did want to edit it to fuck because I thought there's some fun, funny, and interesting stuff in our conversation. So this is going to be a two-parter. Part two will be available for you next Sunday. So what will you get with part one? Well, Think of this like the early years of Josh and the Skints, with some random ramblings sprinkled across the chat along the way. You will hear Josh talking about growing up in Walthamstow and the surrounding areas and going to school. Obviously, we talk about the early lives of the Skints, from sleeping on people's floors to hustling as a band and playing the UK toilet scene. As well as the early years, Josh and I also discuss the art of a good question, the idea of self-censorship, and can you still enjoy a movie or a band if the person in the band or movie has now had incriminating evidence or accusations against them? We also talk about the work that the Skints did with the guests of episode 25. Go back and listen to that, Signature Brew. And we end the podcast talking about bands that should have made it but didn't. As always, your band plays out the show. And this week, he's flying solo. His name is George Gadd, and he's based in my hometown of Nottingham, represent. So stick around for that. But before that, there's this. I present to you this two-parter, this being part one, because that's how numbers work, 1, 2, of episode 27 with me and Josh of the Skints. I will talk to you after our chat. Enjoy.
Like a jacking on the bus when the manager's getting repercussions for the taste of dirt on us. And I'm a fearless little mug that really couldn't give a fuck. If you dig it or you raise it with my views on UK, but well, I can count on my back, the back that I think I worth a damn. For the passion and the love, when none of the factors, I got the man to an empty club. Was them a venue ram? So me and my boys and girl gonna get in the fam. What was I so bland? They don't got no fans. Then I just a whipper up and I like a orphan. You got us up your own brand.
I'm in Walthamstow, and the man in front of me is a DJ, but you were known best as the lyricist, vocalist, and guitarist for the band The Skints, Josh. How are you, man?
I'm all right, man. How are you doing?
I'm good. So we were just talking about the area that we're in, and this is an area whereabouts you... Did you... You grew up here?
Yeah, next door. So I live right next door in an area called Woodford. But the back... This Walthamstow is kind of like where the Skints HQ is.
Yeah.
It's like in the middle. I mean, we're all from... So we're in the Waltham Forest borough of London right now, and band's split between here and... London Borough of Redbridge, which is next door.
Yeah.
So this is kind of like the neighbourhood that's in the middle of where all four of us kind of grown up. And like I said, our rehearsal space and our little band HQ is here. And we did so many like early shows like around here and stuff, man. So.
And are they still like up? Are the venues still there, or they're just
no
taking
way,
over?
Dude. Yeah. And it's not that. It was the Standard at Black Horse Road. That was actually the first ever dream of the Skints, was to play a set at that place. Yeah, it's just
aim high.
Yeah, well, bro, that was it, man. They did the new band night on a Thursday. That was like the first ever mission, you know, the kind of thing where the promoters rip you off, you have to make your own flyer, and yeah, like you give to every, it was like £5 entry, but if you gave your people your flyer, it was £4, you got to keep £1 and all that. And yeah, like the Plough in Wood Street, it's that way. It's like, that's no longer, that was a pub, but that had a function room out the back. We used to put little shows on there and stuff, and yeah, it's gone now, man. Yeah, all of that's gone. It's a real shame.
I mean, in most of like the boroughs of London, like gentrification is just happening, and it keeps coming out more from the central, and now it's like coming out to the east and the south, and I mean, the west has always been kind of uppity, but like it just seems to be now, no matter where you live, the cost is obviously going up, like rent prices are going up, so therefore places that you're talking about are closing down. Like, as a person who, as a band who talk about a lot about London and the sound of London, the vibe of London, how disappointing is that for you, knowing that those places are not there anymore, so people who may be inspired by your music can't go do that? Or do you think that's bollocks? There's always venues, there's always places to find.
I mean, to be honest with you, yeah, I mean, in terms of like that kind of, as we were, like the teenage band, just wanting somewhere to do their thing. I honestly couldn't tell you what is and what... I'm so out of the loop now,
yeah.
You know what I mean? That I honestly couldn't tell you what is and what isn't there. I definitely know that going back to the Standard, that was like a real hub for like new, you know, literally like we were kids at school that want to go outside their school and play a show to their buddies and whoever's else might be around, you know, and just kind of start that part of your life. Like the gentrification thing, I mean, you know, I'm 28 years old, so there's probably people 10, 20, 30 years older than me that would just be like, oh, mate, well, it was, you know, how different it was even back then, like, before you grew up and all that. So I'm maybe not the, I don't have like a full scope on the whole thing. But I know that as somebody that is grown up in the sort of zone 4, zone 3 kind of thing, just to be an adult now, you know, and look to live not at your mum and or dad's house, you feel like you're just being punished for wanting to just live in the area that you like kind of just grown up in, you know what I mean? Not come from far out in the country and want to move to London, isn't that be nice? It's like, oh, I'm just from here, dude.
I can't
rent a room, bro. It's crazy. So, but hey man, there's much worse places to be from in the UK, so
that's massively cool. True. I mean, so the bar that we're in, it's a good old fashioned East End pub, and you've got yourself a Guinness. Is that your normal drink of choice? Are you a Guinness guy?
Well,
or is it...
do you know what? Yeah, I'm not like Guinness have never given me any money, so I don't want to hold them up too much. I like a Guinness. Yeah, I like a Guinness. I'm not.
You
like...
a short drinker though? Do you like your spirits, or are you more like I'll stick on the beer, or are you?
You know what? Like I'm really, maybe when I was younger, I maybe used to, especially on the road, used to maybe like drink a bit more. Really nowadays, I'm like a two cold beers kind of guy. If someone has like a nice spirit to drink, or maybe a nice sunny day, maybe have a gin and tonic if you're listening to some music and hanging out and catching a little vibes. But yeah, I'm not a crazy, like, I don't really drink to get drunk. I kind of just like to. Well, I think hold a little vibe with two cold beers or whatever. I'm all right, mate.
I mean, that whole idea of drinking to get drunk, it gets knocked out of you quite quickly. I found once I hit 18, I was like, oh, well, where's the danger gone now? This is nice, this is okay,
like,
but
you know, with friends and the right mood and right company, like, sure, I like to have a drink, but I'm definitely not a spirits connoisseur, and like I said, I like a Guinness. We did our own beer actually with a local brewery,
Signature Brewery
in Leighton.
We're talking to they're in, well, by the time this has gone out, that episode would have gone out.
Oh, very cool.
So we spoke about the beer that you did. And how did you find that? Like, did you find it actually quite interesting to see how beers were being made, like with different kind of smells and?
Mate, yeah, totally. I mean, it was definitely something that John, our bass player, had the most knowledge and previous interest in.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I would say John is probably the number one alcohol connoisseur of the band. He's like really into his whiskies and stuff like that. But
does he get annoyed if you can't notice the subtle hints of honeysuckle?
No, he wouldn't get annoyed, but he would just, even worse, he'd just like silently think less of you. You know what I mean?
So just that judgment of
But no, the Signature Brew thing was like really like educational and, you know, just inspiring, man. I'm always like, as someone that is like really into like quite a niche thing in life, I'm always just like really quite stoked and inspired to see what other people's things that they go mad over and spend hours and hours trying to be their best thing at. For me, is always like just really cool, man. Just seeing people doing things that they
passionate about.
Yeah, totally. It's wicked. It's what life's about. Yeah.
Definitely. Anyone who's listened to this, haven't got a passion, find a passion. Even if it's like something like knitting or I don't know. Knitting is the first thing that came to my head.
And even if it doesn't even have to be like something that's your job necessarily, which is rich coming from me, because obviously we've been trying to do this for a long time and stuff, and obviously really go at it. But yeah, man, just people taking pleasure in creative things is always nice to witness.
We're going to talk about the Skints and music in a sec, but something that we were kind of messaging about was podcasts. You were saying that you're really into podcasts right now.
I mean, I don't want to say like really into, like there's a few podcasts.
So how many you subscribe to now on your phone?
Do you know what? Like, maybe only two or three. I maybe really might have sold you a bit of a dream in how much into podcasts I am. No, I just... I liked listening to... conversations. Most of the podcasts I listen to are probably music related, right?
Yeah. So name some.
I like. There's actually was only four. I listened to Mike Skinner did a four podcast this year with Murkage Dave, and they had what ones I listened to. They had like Liam Gallagher, Richard Russell from XL. That was really interesting. I can't remember. Maybe like Jamal Edwards from SPTV was on there.
Yeah.
And just like. What I like about certain podcasts, and I listened to Chucky Online's one as well. I think that's really good. Chucky and Poets podcast.
I haven't heard that one.
Yeah. It's kind of a bit more like UK sort of rap scene orientated. Yeah. But I just, what I like about podcasting is that I've always been a big watcher of like interviews with artists. I've always had to know, especially about stuff I like, want to know everything, yeah. I kind of like the new podcasting thing of it's not just the going through the motions, how did you meet, who are your influences, you know what I mean, those things that traditionally I find music journalism can be quite stale in that respect, but I mean, conversational, just like going down a path, even if it goes on a tangent a little bit, and just kind of gaining a bit of knowledge, I kind of quite like listening to that.
So as someone who has also done that journalistic asking the questions, because you get told by your editor these are the questions that need to be asked because you got new listeners and stuff like that, have you had a point where about you've just gone, oh, fuck this, I just can't be asked, like you're not trying, so therefore I'm not going to try?
I mean,
well, you've always been respectful, as in, because I think a lot of people might forget this is still a job for you. You still want to sell yourself and your band in the best way, so therefore you have to be polite to a certain extent.
Yeah, I mean, I would always, I like, I'm sorry if anyone ever didn't, I can't think of one where they would think that, but I would always, anyone that's interested to ask questions about my band, I'd always like to be very respectful and polite, just that, you know, I mean, you don't have to do that at all. You know, journalism, you know, like music, there's an art to it, and some people are better than others, and that's fine. We've done, you know, obviously been in the band for a number of years. Like, we've not really had, like, the band in general has definitely not had press, maybe to the level of where we were at in, like, our kind of live numbers and the touring we've done. We've actually not had, we don't have a crazy PR, we don't have much of a, definitely a mainstream PR presence at all. But obviously, yeah, I've done a lot of interviews and.
But do you feel that's something you need to change, though? Or
yeah,
do you, you're quite happy with it?
Going back to what you were saying, I feel like my feeling is that in the internet age, if you Google the Skints interview, you're going to find a lot of the same questions repeated, you know? So, and that's where I would maybe challenge, especially in kind of like the, maybe the younger, more inexperienced kind of student level people to. Like, they're the ones that should be, like, really pushing the boat out and getting creative with it, you know what I mean? And I think there's something that there's... I think it's probably more fun and more entertaining, because that's your readers or your listeners. It's an audience, right? They're here to be entertained. If, if there's just a less sticking to the rules, maybe.
Yeah.
You know?
Definitely.
Without asking extremely uncomfortable personal questions. That's what, you know what I mean? You know, like I said, there's an art to it.
As someone who is really who enjoys their like the interview format, when you put yourself forward to do these kind of podcasts, are you expecting them to also ask the questions where about you want to know the questions? So something about Liam Gallagher. I'm sure Liam's fucked off about hearing about Noel.
Yeah.
But those questions are there because they're exciting. They're interesting.
Yeah,
that's what you want to know about.
Yeah.
So if there was something... I'm not about to do a gotcha question or anything like that. Don't worry. But like, if there is something like that, are you prepared to ask that question because you know that's something that you would also want to know the answer of if it was someone that you enjoyed and you want to listen to? Or are you like, you know what, fuck, I don't care. I don't care that Jennifer Aniston not fucking got a child or whatever. Like, is that sort of celebrity thing something you don't give a fuck about?
What, in terms of, like, me as a
just a question.
Artist.
Yeah, as an artist. So people delving into, like, your own background. So say if we started talking about your childhood, like, is that something that you go, fuck off, Liam, like, that's got nothing to do with you, and why would I want to talk about that?
That's in itself is a good question. I mean, yeah, I mean, obviously, primarily, like, me being in the Skints, to me, is about music. That's why I'm here. And music is kind of, in terms of my life, the thing that I I'm like most at home talking about, but I mean, you know, I don't really have any qualms about just answering general human questions either. I don't know. I've never really thought about it like that. I've just always sort of rolled along with whatever the question is.
Got time to an artist who gives up their time to spend a long time with you, in the case of we're doing this for about an hour or so, I feel it's always my responsibility to ask good questions. So one of the things when I was researching about you, I was impressed by your depth and knowledge of music. It seems to be, you kind of mentioned it, that you eat, breathe, like you want to know about anything that interests you. Like, is that to the point of obsessive? Like, are you like, I want to know everything about that person. So I want to know like their first album they ever done. I want to know if they've ever done like a B-side that I've never heard. Or is it a case of, I like this music, I want to know the basic about it, and then I'll move on. Because I don't understand how you retain that knowledge.
Yeah, to me it kind of depends on the artist, depends on like my mood, depends on like how much of a, you know, the fire has been lit within me to like access the knowledge, you know. And sometimes it comes with time as well, like I'm talking to other people that, you know what I mean, I learn a lot, obviously, like, you know, you can learn a lot of facts from the internet, like, and the back of record covers.
I'm sorry, I'm about to do the bunny ears for the facts on the internet.
You know, there's a plethora of knowledge out there, and, you know, obviously, you know, if you're really into, I don't know, for example, like credits on an album, there's like the back cover or the inside, and you can find out, you know, about the producer or, or whoever was playing on it and things like that. But then there's also, I think, a lot to be learned about just talking to other people that are into similar things as well. And, you know, I've got into artists and finding out about them so much, people whose music I've loved, and you know, you find out maybe a bit too much about their personal life, and then you question whether you should maybe even be supporting their music or anything like that. So, yeah, man, I don't know. Do you know what? Yeah, I don't really have like a format or a formula. There's like different things. I mean, maybe like when I was younger, I would maybe go to some like more like going into the cave of maybe more artists than I do now.
Yeah.
But if there's something like new right now that really excites me, I might, you know, just try and find every song ever. It's really different, man.
It's kind of interesting what you touched on there about you dive into an artist and they might find out something that you probably shouldn't know. There's obviously in a world whereabouts now people are being accused of many things.
Mm.
Let's say, for instance, Kevin Spacey. I'm a massive I was a Kevin Spacey fan. I love his films. And I was having this discussion with a friend, like, can you still enjoy a Kevin Spacey movie knowing what he has been accused of doing? And my argument is, yeah, because I enjoy him as that character. I'm not enjoying him as a person.
Sure.
I'm enjoying that character, and I can remove myself from what he's done. I wouldn't now support him with his new films because him as an artist is someone who I don't really respect anymore, but I respect his past work. Like, can you get on board with that, or is that something that you find difficult?
I kind of know what you mean. Like, obviously, like, you know, with something like that or similar cases where someone has like committed literally like heinous acts that just can't be condoned or whatever, like
Lost Prophets, for instance,
right? So, I mean you know, that's like a super super extreme version, but like obviously, like, you know, there's no getting around or for me, especially in that case, like, that's just, you know, forget about it forever. But with something like, you know, it's also weird, like, if you like something, it's like a music artist or, you know, has like maybe views that you don't agree with, but you like their tune. For me, I don't know, like, is there a rule book that says, like, just because I like this tune means that I'm on board with everything this guy has ever thought politically or done in his life behind closed doors?
Yeah.
Probably not, you know what I mean? So...
But there's an interview...
It's a bit of a mad one, though. I know what you mean.
There's an interview coming up that, again, hasn't been aired with Joe from The Queers. And he got into a Twitter war about him talking about his belief... He basically started raising money for a police officer who shot and killed a black child in America. And his
really?
Argument, yeah.
Wow.
But his, I mean, the police officer got basically not guilty on manslaughter. And the FBI claimed that the child came at the officer, whereabouts the family say actually he had his hands up. So there's a lot of like contradictions. But he firmly planted his flag in the police officer's corner. And obviously being in the punk community...
Why? Was he like related to the guy?
No relation. But his argument was that I believe in law and order, so therefore, why wouldn't I support a police officer? Why wouldn't I? If I was in that situation, I want that police officer to support me. I could attack him, because I don't agree with what he was saying, but I feel that he should have the opportunity to be able to speak that, and he should have the opportunity to believe that. And I don't believe that as a punk community, which I believe... should be liberal and with their thinking and their mindset, we should allow that space to happen and we should allow them to believe that, but then also question them when we feel it's appropriate. And even with this podcast, I've had discussions with my friends of, I want to talk to anyone associated with punk, but should I also then go and talk to people like Screwdriver? Because they are still a part of this community. They have been part of the punk community.
They're not part of my community, mate.
They're not part of your community, but they're still punk. They're not my punk, but they're still punk. So should I ignore that?
I mean, I would, to counter that, I would say, like, you're doing a Christian podcast, should you go and interview the KKK, because they claim to be Christians as well?
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Or whatever, you know what I mean? It's like, yeah, that's all a bit mad, man. I mean, yeah, I guess it's, you know, it's your thing, your rules, mate.
I'm not saying I'm gonna, but yeah, yeah. It's that argument of, should I just limit it to people who have my own liberal views, or should I open it up to people whereabouts I do have that discussion and that debate? But then it's kind of like Tommy Robinson. Like, Tommy Robinson is someone who I know because I grew up in Luton. I don't know him personally, but I know of him. And the media seem to have come around. So there's a lot of American listeners who's not going to know who Tommy Robinson is. Basically, Tommy Robinson is part of a far-right organization who are racist as fuck. But for some reason, the media have jumped on him as someone as freedom of speech, which is bollocks. But he was on Newsnight last night, given a platform, talking about, should he be censored? Should we be doing that? Should we be giving them a platform? Or should we let their own stupidity come out and then we judge them as a community? This is taking a really weird tangent.
Yeah, it's gone a bit left. But, yeah, I mean, like, the censorship route is kind of crazy. But I would argue that it's kind of, you know, with the media, at least in this country, like, it's not as simple as, like, oh, should this idiot be allowed to speak or that idiot allowed to speak. Like, it's so corrupt from the get-go that actually I don't really think you can kind of really fairly, like, measure certain things within, like, mainstream media platforms, at least, anyway. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? It's kind of flawed from the off, in my opinion, and to some knowledge that I have kind of, you know, attained just kind of by looking and watching. So yeah, it's all mad, bro.
Let's get this back on to the track, the stream of music. So who was the person who brought music into your life? Was it family? Is your family really big into their music, or was it your friends who brought music into your life?
My mom and dad are definitely big music listeners. Neither of them are musicians. My mum has like a dancing kind of slightly musical theatre kind of background. You know, she was kind of a, you know, as an ensemble dancer and stuff. Like back in the day, I kind of came along and ruined her career by my very birth. And you know, her and my dad were like big, like in the 80s, I guess they were out like raving and kind of like the, on like a soul kind of disco, early R&B kind of tip, like a bit of a funky one as well. So there's definitely, it was always music in the house, some quite good music. My uncle, big record collector, probably a lot of stuff that put me on the path of like what would become the vision for the Skints, maybe was turned onto me by him.
Yeah.
Definitely like first heard like dub and probably like even like the Specials or like, I knew about Clash before, but then he showed me all like Judgment Time and Armageddon, them kind of more like punky reggae Clash ones that I maybe didn't know. I knew about London Calling and all that.
Yeah.
I'm talking about when I'm like 13 or something.
Yeah. Could you appreciate the music at that time or for what it was? Or was it just like, I like this beat?
Yeah, well, you know, it was, I guess like there was music in the home. So like I knew, you know, there's always like Radio 1 in the morning, having your cereal, going to school, and that. Like, I was, music was always around in the house. And then I guess probably like towards the end of primary school, so maybe like year 5, something like that, like was really into like the rap that was whatever on the radio at the time, like hip hop, was really loving that, And then I kind of, and then probably about year 6, skateboarding happened to me. And then that's when, as well as like the hip hop and like garage, remember in this area, like where East London meets Essex, like the garage thing was like the sound. So that was just everywhere. And I like that. But then with the skateboarding came the intro into, I guess like, rock, you know, Green Day, Nirvana kind of early entry.
So was that punk. Was that you looking because you wanted to know more about the skate community, and then the skate community were playing that kind of music and they were like, Josh, listen to this?
Yeah, maybe. Or maybe, to be honest with you.
Or like MTV2 late at night.
Going back to 11 years old at this point. No, with me at MC, I never had cable in the house. So I actually, all Kerrang TV and all things like that, that I maybe see around my friends' houses, I never actually had in my house. But I guess like I probably must have just seen some like skate kids wearing like a Toy Machine hoodie or something, thought that was cool. I don't know. Who knows, man? But like, yeah, that like Green Day, obviously like at the time, like Blink-182 would have been really big. And I was definitely like aware, like when I was finding out about rock music originally, it was definitely everything that was like loosely punk related was what I was into. And actually I never really got into rock as a, or metal at all as a whole genre.
Yeah.
And that would, you know, I've never listened to, it's going to sound like sacrilege to some people, I've never listened to a Led Zeppelin album. Like, not top to bottom.
Tunes.
I've never listened to, like, an AC/DC album all the way through. But, like, you know, the kind of big bands.
The bands that should be in your record collection.
Or, like, or the people that are into guitar music would argue, like, oh, how can you have not... Yeah. But everything, you know, and then, like... I remember, being, you know, being into Green Day or whatever and coming home and be like, oh, yeah, like, Mum, like, I like punk. My mum was like, oh, yeah, like, I've got... like Sex, like mum, and then my mum's like idea of like punk would have been like Sex Pistols and Clash and all that. She would be like, oh, do you know about this? And show me all like late 70s stuff. And then, like I said, like from my uncle, and that was like, oh yeah, do you know about Specials? Do you know about whatever else? I don't know, can't even think, like the Beat,
yeah,
or something like that. And then,
the Selector and all that.
Yeah,
kind of
and then
stuff,
like, and then you know, and then I'm getting, so I'm then like 11. I go to high school like 11, and then like it's kind of, you know, into, still into all the rap stuff, but then you find you're getting a little bit deeper, so you're going into like your Less Than Jakes and whatever else. Obviously still big at this time.
Yeah.
And like they might have, probably would have still been written about in Kerrang and things like that, which I would have been buying. So, and like skating and just that whole like classic skate punk existence, while still I was always constantly listening to what was like big in the area at the time, which was not rock music at all, but obviously through just like skateboarding and those kind of friends that I had there.
Yeah.
That was, I was still in tune with that. And yeah, man, like, you know, Rancid, NOFX, all of that stuff, like really early kind of shapings of adolescence. Yeah.
So with that, and with clearly your love of music, did you go to school and not understand why everyone else loved music as much as you, or were you surrounding yourself with people who loved music?
Well, I definitely was like, if in my school, like, if you liked guitar music, you was like a severe minority.
You're a gribo. It was like that.
Yeah,
sort
pretty
of
much. Yeah, yeah. You know what I mean? Like, you would just like, you know, grunger freaks.
Yeah.
Grunger was the word, even though technically most of what we were listening to really wasn't grunge music at all. Yeah. But it was the thing, and you know, bunch of that little crowd, and that was in my school, or in our school, my band school. All those kids were from various different year groups would all like kind of hang out together.
Yeah.
Even though like it was different age, you know, like John and Jamie like were older than me and Marcia. Me and Marcia went primary school together, went high school, and were like same age in that. But all those kids used to hang out, bonded together by kind of just alternative music, I suppose. And like I said, while I still appreciated everything else, I was very aware that like everyone else in my school was just consuming what was right in front of them. And it's fine, do you know what I mean? They're school children.
Yeah.
I don't think I pretty really judged, but I kind of did kind of know that what I was not satisfied with, like, just whatever everyone else was into.
Yeah, yeah.
I knew there had to be more, and yeah, man, was just mad with it from then, like, and sharing music at the time. This is really like still like CD Walkman days and burning CDs with your friends and all that. Like, maybe like this is probably like just before like internet. I don't know about everyone else, but in my house this was like pre like having good enough internet to like download anything.
Yeah.
So it was still like sharing,
having that good.
And then maybe
noise.
When I was about 14, the internet was maybe good enough to start like the LimeWire thing and all that, and then you can really start going crazy with finding different tunes from different genres or whatever. But John from the Skints was the first person to show me like Cap Down and King Prawn.
Oh yeah, yeah. So like British.
Yeah. So I didn't
punk.
Really
yeah,
know
yeah.
about. Actually, yeah, that was probably a thing. Like I said, like, you know, you start with your Green Day, and then maybe it's a whatever, a Rancid or a NOFX and Lesson Jake. Like going down that whole thing.
Yeah.
It was probably like John from the Skints that brought me to like, oh yeah, you know, there's like bands doing that in England now.
Yeah.
That like are playing gigs and we can go to them.
Yeah. Yeah.
You
yeah.
know what I mean? And that was like a whole, what do you mean?
I am not
What was your first gig you went to then?
Oh, my first ever gig. Do you know what? The first gig I went to is the only... I actually had a conversation with someone recently. I felt like a chump because I was like, nah, I've never been to like arena gigs. I was like, the biggest gig I could have ever imagined when I was younger was like the Astoria. But actually, when I was 11, I went to see Destiny's Child at London Arena with my family.
Yeah, man.
That's the only arena show I've been to. It was incredible. Yeah. But then that was like maybe when I just wasn't as into music. And then I reckon the first gig I went to was probably like that venue I said, the Standard in Walthamstow. Just like a shithole Sticky Four club venue. And there was just some band playing there.
Can you remember your first pit as well? Can you,
yeah. The first pit, yeah. Do you know what? The first pit I went to... It's crazy because we've played with them a bunch since then. It was like 2003. I was 13. I was at the Underworld. And it was... So your man... Oh, I can't remember his name. He's not been in the band since we played with them. There was the dude from Real Big Fish who had a side band, right?
Forces of Evil.
No.
No.
Littlest Man Band.
Yep.
I think the guy's name is Scott from Real
Scott.
Big Fish.
Yeah.
So he started this band that was like nothing like Real Big Fish. It was kind of a lot more, wasn't ska, it was kind of mature, but I was like online like looking for a gig that was like Real Big Fish to go to. And I went, and it was Suburban Legends were the main support.
Yeah.
We know those guys now. They're like a lot more like a Real Big, you know, like a classic Southern California, like ska, punk, third wave.
Yeah.
And I went to that show. And like, I remember, yeah, the beginning and the skanking like a little nutter in pretty checkerboard slip-on Vans. And you know what I mean? What you're supposed to be doing when you're 13, man.
Definitely.
That was what I remember, like, first doing, like, skanking like a little nutter.
So when was the last time you went in a pit?
Oh, mate. Do you know what? And through all my teenage years as well, like, I was up for it as well, man. Like hardcore punk shows, hardcore shows, ska shows. I just had so much energy like that I just cannot imagine having now.
Yeah.
But the last time I did, it must have been one. I can't remember. I remember the last time... I used to hurt myself all the time. I remember the last time really mashing myself up was when Capdown first got back together. And that was after they split up. And this was probably like 2011. So we're like around... We're definitely a band in the scene and been touring. But like I was still... And I still do, man. Love off Capdown for forever. But I remember they played at the Underworld. And I'm like watching from the side of the stage. Yeah, and they were playing Positivity. And I'm like... run across the stage to like crowd surf to jump into the crowd, and I've just slipped on spilt water on the stage and just fucked up my elbow so bad, bruv. And then I think there's a video of it online somewhere. You can see me just drop, and then like I jump into the crowd, I'm like holding my elbow, terrible. But no, it's been a good few years, man. I mean, like I said, I'm 28 now. I haven't been a serious pitter for a long time, man. Been out the loop, but maybe that band to like bring me back, I don't know. No, I'll get broken now. I can't do it, man.
Well, actually, last time I was in a pit was actually, it wasn't one of your gigs, but you were supporting. It was actually a NoFX show.
And at Brixton.
Yeah, and I'm a huge NoFX fan. Like, they've always been my band since I was a kid. Like, whenever they come over, they're the band I always want to go watch. And I was like, I'm gonna fucking go for it. Come on. And I went in, and I was in like for like two songs. I came out, felt winded. I was like, fuck, what happened to my youth? I just felt really old and really battered and a bit depressed, if I'm honest. Yeah. I was like, oh, now I know my limits.
Totally, man. No, I'm too much of a wuss now, man. If I get a crack in the ribs or someone's stepping on my trainers, I'm just going to be moody. It's not good, man.
So I'm not going to start talking about how the Skints formed or where you met, because I feel that's been... done enough.
Yeah,
and I mean, a lot. And cool. If you want to know, you can go.
If you know,
that.
You know, band from school started very in its most primitive form, and we just never stopped.
And I don't know if you know this, but on Wikipedia, you are noticed as notable alumni from Woodbridge High School.
Okay, well, there you go. I don't know anyone else that of any repute that went to our school, so.
Just you, according to Wikipedia.
Unfortunately, so it doesn't surprise me, but you know, got 7 GCSEs out of them, so there you go.
So when you met Marcia, Jonathan, and Jamie,
yeah.
Did you already know that they were quite talented musically? Or was it just a fluke? Because I know Marcia is classically trained.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, definitely, like, in the kind of, like, doing your grades as a thing, you know, like, on the flute and stuff. So, obviously, I knew me and Marcia went primary together. And so, going into Woodbridge, we weren't, like, best mates at primary school or nothing. But, obviously, like I said, when we realised that we were into similar things at high school, we kind of maybe buddied up a bit more. And she, I definitely knew she played the flute. But, you know what? It wasn't really, Marcia actually came into the, my idea for doing the Skints was when I spoke to her and was like, yeah, like, do you reckon you can play the sax? And she was like, oh, my dad's got one, like, I think it's a bit like the flute, I'll give it a go. And then John, who was like I said, a little bit older than us, he was like playing the bass with his buddy Louis, who was playing guitar. They were just kind of doing their little thing, yeah. And then John was like playing all like Offspring bass lines and stuff. And then I was like trying to start a band, and John was like, what? Like, I'm older than you. Like, you can't be like doing a band. Like, I'm going to play the bass or whatever. And then Jamie was someone that I knew. Yeah, because he obviously, when I got to high school in year seven, Jamie was a couple years older, and he was already playing in local bands and stuff. So Jamie, from the day I met him, I knew he was a music guy. But obviously, it was years until we was never in a band together or anything. So yeah, like, definitely music and our friendship were always like connected, but it was like friends first. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? It's like, we're friends anyway and we love music, and that's probably what brought us together, but regardless of whether we could play music together or not, would not be seen for a few years.
So where did the idea that there'd be three vocalists in the band come from then? Or like, did it start off like that, or was it you were the main vocalist and then you decided this isn't working? Or how, I mean, how, where did it come
from?
You
know what, it actually, it started with just me, and it was like really bad, you know what I mean? I've got the worst voice in the band, that's, I'll happily admit that. No, I have, but it's fine, because there's, do you know what I mean, two good ones. It's alright, I can write like lyrics and that, it's fine, but and
I
express myself and whatever, I do my thing, but no one wants to hear like a soulful reggae track with me as the lead vocal. It's fun. But so yeah, obviously the band started like a lot more on kind of the scrappy ska core kind of tip.
Yeah.
And I was kind of the lead vocal, and like Marcy was doing the sax and that, and John, to be fair to the history of the band, we did have a few early shows with a couple of early incarnations that were not the lineup as you know it now, but obviously since 2007, which is, you know, only a year or two after that would have been, it's been asked for seriously with it. And then when Jamie kind of joined on the drums, you know, I knew he was a great singer and songwriter anyway, and it just started happening, man. He was great. Jamie joined the band, I was like, oh great, yeah, like I've been listening to like loads of reggae and I've written some stuff like this. And I think it was actually Sociopath, which is a song on our first album, was like the first thing that Jamie like brought to the Skints, was like, shall we try a little reggae tip? And we were like, okay, cool, right, I think this is opening up a bit of like a new world to the sonic possibilities. And then Marcia, it was kind of me and Jamie like doing different parts on the lead for a while, and Marcia would like be doing BVs. And then it was really for our first album that she kind of wrote her first, like, pretty sure, like, Rowena song, which is the closing track on our first album. It's actually the only one on that album that Marcia sings lead on. I'm pretty sure that's like the first song she wrote to sing.
Yeah, you know, I mean, we're gonna get onto how I like Marcia's obviously grown as a a vocalist throughout the band, but for some reason in my head, because I've read a lot whereabouts Marcia talks about that she's classically trained, was there a moment like straight out of Compton, like, you know, that have you seen Straight Out of Compton, whereabouts Eazy-E's in the booth and all of a sudden he just lays it down, and like the way that Marcia can sometimes like spit out her lyrics, was it that kind of like, holy fuck, where did this come from and why haven't you been doing it more? Or was it you always knew that Marcia had that in her to be able to really rapidly throw out lyrics?
I think it's probably more the latter. It wasn't like, just obviously because of knowing her, like, musical, you know, she was always, like, very involved in kind of, like, the sculpting of the music and that. And, like, she's, you know, always, like, very forward with the ideas and all that, it was not surprising that she becomes, you know, a serious songwriter in her own right. So it wasn't really that. It was more just like, I don't know, man. Like, when you just do it all the time and day by day and you're all learning things and you're trying to get better, it just sort of happened. It wasn't really like this moment of like, oh, I can't believe you've been like hiding this ability or whatever. Do you know what I mean? It's like, and I don't mean that in a bad way, but like in a, yeah, like of course we knew that she would be able to do that because of, you know, the talent she's got.
I always wondered what I was gonna be. Another bitter woman on a bus with a cat in a magazine. My mind is jaded by the multiple painful memories, and I'm haunted by the regrets that I let get to me. I think a lot at night when I can't sleep about the haters amongst us in this society, about the ignorance that surrounds just everything they say, about the lengths we go to try and hide our own mistakes. I don't care what you say, who you are, nothing is alright about war. I don't care what you say, who you are, nothing is alright about war. I don't care where there's oil, who's your God, nothing is alright about war. I don't care what you say, who you are, nothing is alright about war. Said a warning, money is an image, shall a man can go wild, I'm a bit of a formidable, a rare tiny little bits of metal, trying to represent the fabrication, there is no exaggeration of the money in this nation, that's objective, was illegal, to start a legal war, I don't think every person asking what the hell that was for, I don't care where it is or who's it or. Nothing is alright about war, not a little bit of sense in it, not a little bit of sense in it, what do we dedicate our lives to, some of the system, I got my number, listen, and the money doesn't exist, so this is going as it does me, I don't see so long, I've seen the reasons I can flip, left a little bit of bitterness and jealousy, suppose I feel a psychological anomaly, my life is not familiar, I want to see my family, I don't care.
The first time I saw you live was in 2010, February, in Luton, because I was DJing at club night.
Wow,
and
I remember that show.
You were playing with Mouthwash and Random Hand.
Yeah.
And you're shaking your head.
No, because I only have a gig we played in Luton, so I knew as soon as you said it, I knew exactly the gig it was.
And I can remember watching it, thinking, like, this is going to be the bands who are going to dominate music. Because to me, like, you guys were like the three bands who were killing it at the time in the music scene, and now you're the only band full time that's standing. Had there been a point during that time where about you've gone, fuck this, man, like, this is so hard, why are we doing this, like, you didn't feel like there was momentum, or has it always been step by step by step, you've had bigger crowds?
Yeah, I think luckily for us, the reason that we are still here is that, like, even though it's been like super gradual and like super slow, like, there has always been like constant, at whatever rate, there has been constant visible growth, and like it hasn't for us felt like, you know, it has been like on an upward gradient,
yeah,
but just over a very slight upward gradient over a very long period of time. And for that, and obviously, like, man, you know, doing this does not come without its financial woes and, you know, other woes and whatnot. But we've discussed this before, and it is mad out of how, like, that's kind of the world that we come from. And we are, I believe, and anyone else listening may correct me on this, the only band that is currently in existence that does it full time and is kind of still making a real go of it from that whole world.
Yeah.
Which is crazy, because like you said, man, there was a point where I was like, bro, I thought Mouthwash were gonna blow, seriously blow. And yeah, it's crazy to be here at 28, having been in the band for, you know, since I was like 17 or whatever, and the amount of bands we've seen live and die.
Yeah.
Is like, you know, you feel like a war veteran or something, man. You know,
I've seen things.
Yeah.
Seen things,
truly.
Brother.
You know, and obviously, like, a lot of the old names, like, still do like, play out and stuff.
Yeah.
Which is great, but it's not really in the same energy as, like, when you're doing a band full-time touring. There's kind of a different vibe between that and a band that goes out and does a few festivals every year, you know what I mean?
But you've done your dues, like with the first album, you were booking your own shows, you were sleeping on floors and that kind of stuff. I mean, looking back now, is there any point where you've gone, oh, they were psychopaths, and then when you have to sleep on somebody else's floor and you're like, you're looking for a room and you're thinking that guy's dodgy as fuck, but we need to sleep, like you had that, because I used to live with a guy, well, the people who put you on in Luton, DTA Promotions, we used to have bands staying in our student house all the time, and I always felt a bit weird for them because they're coming in a stranger's house, like we don't know you.
Oh bro, do you know what, it's kind of mad because like obviously we're in a position now where it's hotels rather than strangers' floors, but we're still doing the same thing. Do you know what I mean? So I do look, there's stories and that from that time that I'm like, oh mate, like that was mad. Like how were we like going on like that? Like, you know, for months on end. But at the same time, I'm like, is it more mad that we're still doing the same thing? Do you know what I mean? But yeah, man, I mean, like, bro, we were so young, man. You know I mean, literally, to be, like, 18, 19, we're just, like, on stage, like, asking someone, can we stay on your floor tonight? Like,
yeah.
People, like, yeah, I mean, we've had the best time ever, but I feel like normal people, like, wouldn't do it. People just wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
For, like, no money and for, like, you know, you ask, like, an artist now, a young artist now, just like signed to like, you know, a major label, and the dreams and aspirations they've got for their career, maybe they're in like the kind of development process, and like tell them they've got to go and do that, they won't do it, bro. They'll just be like, what are you talking about? Like, yeah. I want to be on the bus and I want to be playing to thousands of people. Like, I'm not going on tour around England for a month playing every day, not knowing where I'm staying every night, and like for like £5. Yeah. But like, for, do you know what I mean? Between you and figuring it out how you'll get into the next gig next day, people just wouldn't do it. So maybe there's something wrong with us, man. I don't know.
How much time you got?
As long as you need, dude. Mate, keep rolling, man. Yeah. I'd seen my accountant today. That was as a professional as it got earlier. So yeah.
Seen your accountant. Would you think you would ever mutter those words when you were 17, sleeping on people's floors?
No, but to still be doing it, I'm glad that I am.
Yeah.
Because it shouldn't be me. Do you know what I mean? I'm glad that there's someone now that's job is to check that stuff out.
Yeah. We spoke about like you booking your own tours and stuff like that. What was the one thing that you've taken from doing that you still remember and still take with you every single time you go on tour?
Right.
Like the fails and also the successes as well. Okay, we did that, let's never fucking do that ever again.
Yeah, okay, so with the, just to spread some clarity on the booking our own tours, obviously a lot of the early shows were like self-booked and like our two very, very early, you know, I use the word tours lightly, were maybe self-booked, and between us and actually want to take a second to big up Clay Pigeon, who is no longer a band, but they're a band from this area. You know, they were kind of the band that we really aspired to be and we wanted to open up for. Credible, underrated, under-listened to, under-seen band. And they kind of, we did like our first tour with them. But actually, quite early on, we did secure a, you know, underground punk rock booking agent, who kind of, that was how we got on that toilet tour constant circuit for a couple of years. So even though like everything our end was done ourselves in terms of like being there and logistically and, you know, and the fees were like £75 a night or whatever, and you got to make that work. In terms of like the actual booking, that was handled by someone else. And then that took us up to a couple of years when we went with our current agent, Ross, who we've been with now for like about 8 years.
Yeah.
But then, yeah, everything else has pretty much been handled by us and various associated parties along the way. So, yeah, I don't want people to think that I've booked every single tour date the Skints have ever done.
Yeah.
But, you know, a lot of it was just watching and figuring it out, man. And, you know, learning and listening, you know, to your kind of peers in other bands and what's gone wrong for them, you know, and what's gone right for them. And, you know, I think a wise man learns from his own mistakes, but a wiser man can learn from the mistakes of others. And in the music industry, at whatever level, you know, there's a lot to learn from other people's mistakes. And just like, you know, people just be looked up to, man. Like you're the whole like 90s, like stuff like Fat Records and like bands like NoFX and the whole like real like remaining independent and holding on to the rights of your records and not putting yourself in a position where you're going to be dicked over by a record label or anyone can tell you when you can or cannot be on tour or if you can or cannot release music.
Yeah.
And just like, you know, holding that power, even if it means that you ain't going to be the biggest band in the world ever, just, you know, being in control of your own thing was just principles that we still take very seriously and have really probably avoided us from making kind of bad business decisions in the past. You know, because of that was kind of, like I said, like when I was younger, like a rancid at the London Astoria was like as big as I could imagine a gig being. Yeah.
Yeah.
We'd never really had like aspirations of being like an arena touring artist, so maybe that's why we never really had aspirations to like go and see what the major labels are saying, because we just wasn't really in the mission.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
I feel we should get another drink. Well, we're gonna take a little intermission and we'll be back in 2 seconds.
Beer break.
Thank you to Josh for giving up his time. Part two of this interview will be in your grubby little mitts on December the 16th. And then we'll be back for our Punks in Pubs Christmas episode on Sunday the 23rd. We are packing them in like your mum packs in stuffing. That was meant to sound like a Christmas joke, but it ended up sounding a bit sexual. So sorry for that. Don't forget, t-shirts are available to pre-order, limited stock. So get your order in now. Send an email to punksinpubs@gmail.com with your size and name, and we will stash it to one side for you so when they go on general sale and you will have first dibs on sizes. Quick thank you to Stephen Burke for his audio assistance, and a preemptive thank you to you for A, keep on listening after the interview has stopped, and B, for going online and rating and reviewing this podcast on iTunes or whatever streaming service you use. Time to end the show, so that means your band plays us out. This week he's going solo, he's from the city of my birth, his name is George Gadd, and he has talent. This track is called Not Human. Make sure you check him out if he's playing in your area. Right, that's it for me. If you go into a punk show and you see someone fall down, you pick them right back up. Until next time, well, until next week, bye-bye.
Not ready for hell just yet. Come and dim my spirit and leave the light. Oh, I'm an empty shell. I'm a vacant body. Zapper shot the warning signs. Gravity forever in the morning light. And I felt lost and had to hide. But I am not human anymore. I'm not human anymore. I'm not human anymore. And his heart is old. To older his heat. But the past presently killing. I can't shut it off. Like a cold machine, I can't shut it off. As I brush off the warning signs, corporating forever in the morning light. I felt lost and had to hide, but I am not human anymore. I'm not human anymore. I'm not human anymore. One awful lie, don't tell me otherwise. Look me in the eye and tell me that you never lied.
anymore. I'm not human anymore. I'm not human anymore. No, I'm not human anymore. I'm not human anymore. I'm not human anymore. No, I'm not human anymore. I'm not human anymore. I'm not human anymore.